tell us what you do, who you are, and what you do.
Okay. So thank you very much, Charles, for this time to do this recording. I'm indeed grateful, and I see it as a privilege to be in a position to have a opportunity to share experience and ideas with young people that you are targeting with this information. My name is Gabriel Okewo. I am the principal lead of Budget Foundation. Budget is a civic tech organization that works to promote transparency and accountability in Nigeria.
Okay, great. So, on an average day as the principal lead, what do you do?
On an average day as a principal lead, that question is wide, because as branches, as sub-branches and all of that, you know. So as a principal lead, my work cuts across, like, if I would call it, maybe two broad areas, or maybe three. One is administrative, one is technical, and the other is stakeholder management. So as the principal lead of the organization, I think my work starts from the administrative part of my work, right? Every day, like when I come into the office, you want to check and be sure that everybody is fine. Whoever you are not seeing on seat, you are able to check on the person to know is either the person is gone out for a meeting, or if the person is not at work because he's not feeling well, you want to be sure you are reaching out to the person, or maybe the HR is reaching out to the person, you know, just administrative process. You are signing papers, approving documents, looking into, books and all of that. Then on the technical part, right, the organization is made up of different teams, and different teams having their own objective, having what they are working on, and you just want to be in the know of what they are doing. You want to share ideas with them, you want to share review documents, you want to look at what they are doing and just give your input. And then on the other side, which is stakeholder management, that is outside the organization. So for the organization to continue to run, there are people that are regarded as stakeholders, right? Both upper stakeholders, donor stakeholders, government stakeholders, community stakeholders, citizen stakeholders. You also want to, my job is also to keep a full glance at what is happening to our stakeholders, and to ensure that our stakeholders are well managed, to be able to continue to support us if they are donors, to continue to follow our work if they are our followers or ordinary citizens, to be sure that we are not stepping on toes unnecessarily, right? Especially when we talk about government stakeholders and the kind of work that we do, to be sure that information we are putting out to our stakeholders is objective, is also true, so that we are not maligning anyone in the course of doing our work.
Wow. That's a lot, to Gabriel. It's like managing Nigeria. Well, good to know. I'm happy for what you guys are doing and what you do also specifically. So now, looking at what you do, how do you think education prepared you for this particular position as the principal lead of Budget? What role did education play? Or it was education had no role in it.
Funny enough, that question right now can be okay. So for me, I will come back to me, but the truth of the matter is, let's just focus on me. So without education, I would definitely not be where I am today. And education now, right? And why I wanted to digress a little the other time is because education now has gone beyond the four walls of school, right? Education now is about skill acquisition, is about what you have done consistently, and you have built experience and knowledge, you know, you have become an expert in what you know how to do or what you have fled to do. So education for me is beyond the four walls of school. So yes, I've gone through all levels of education, from primary to secondary to university to first master's, and now running a second master's, you know. So we can't take education away from whatever I've become today. But in terms of what I'm doing, right, the starting point of building a career in the development sector started from a skill that I have, right, that I acquire outside the four walls of the school, which is data analysis skill, right? Just ability to use Excel, ability to use SPSS, which is a statistical software, a software that is used to analyze surveys and all of that. That was a skill I acquired not in school. I acquired from someone I saw that was quite good using those skills, and I learned from that person. And when I was going to start my career in 2007, if I can remember very clearly, what got me into an NGO environment was because I was able to use Microsoft Excel and SPSS to analyze data and survey. And I mean, I started from there, and today this is where I am. I've gone around. I've been places. I've worked around in Nigeria a bit. I've also gone out, worked across five West African countries: Nigeria, Benin, Togo, Ghana, and Cote d'Ivoire. And now I'm back to Nigeria doing this with budget.
Wow, good to know, Gabriel. Okay, so now you mentioned skill acquisition. I know that in school, that's one of the things that some people say is lacking, because what employers need is different from what people are being taught in school. And so how would you advise young people to take advantage of that? So I'm in school, for example, and they're not teaching me Microsoft Excel, for example, like what you learned. How do I learn it? Where can technology, how does technology come into play in acquiring skill, even as a student?
Okay, so that's a very good question. And I really hope that young people that will listen to this or watch this interview will take what I want to say very importantly, right? Because what you need to do, you don't need to confine yourself to the syllabus or just what you are being taught in school, right? It is one of the advantages I would say that I have. Early in life, I was able to identify what I want to do, right? And I was also able to quickly identify someone that is already working in the path of a career I choose to do, that I took as a role model. And I stayed put under that person, allowing that person to teach me all the way. It was not easy, because sometimes when you just feel like you want to go and greet this person, you eventually get there and he's asking you, do you have your laptop? Do you have your flash drive? And start teaching you even when you are not interested, right? And those things are what came together to make me what I am today. I will give you an example, right? As at when I was in 200 level, I studied sociology, by the way, first degree. I studied sociology. When I got to 200 level in sociology, I began to look out for, and as at that time, the reigning job was banking job. Everybody wants to work in a bank. And I'm just curious about what alternative do we have to banking job, right? Then I now began to hear about NGO development work. And from there, I had this role model, this big brother that is a friend, Dr. Ojo, right? He's a medical doctor. He still is a medical doctor, but he was also crossing from clinical medicine to working in the public health, but for an NGO, not for a hospital, right? So yeah. I was able to take a clue from him, right? And even he was able to help me understand that what I am even studying is more relevant to community work, to social development, than even, I mean, of course, medicine is relevant everywhere, but he was able to make me understand that what I'm studying is more relevant, right? So I then stayed put on that, paid more attention to my studies, pay more attention to what skills is going to be relevant for me to thrive in the industry. And I will give you an example. When I went to serve, I served in Plateau State, a Hausa community state, right? Hausa speaking state, where I should have been learning how to speak Hausa because I served in Plateau State in the northern state. That was where I enrolled to learn French. And why did I enroll to learn French? Because while I was looking out for what skills would make me to thrive in the development sector, I realized that for you to thrive in the development sector, the ability to speak a second language will always count for you. Mm-hmm. So I learned French. I have a working knowledge of French, I mean. And when I was going to get my first job post NYSC, the first job I got was a regional job, a job that would take me along five countries. I was going to be based in Benin Republic, which is a French-speaking country. The position was reserved for a Nigerian that also has a working knowledge of French.
French, wow.
So preparation, the way I prepared myself, is just looked as if I consciously prepared myself for the opportunity, right? Mm. But the truth of the matter is, I prepared myself because I know what I wanted to do. And when the opportunity came, I was a perfect fit for that opportunity.
Wow. Wow. You know, my last question would have been advice to young people, but for everything you have said, everything is advice to young people. And I like that illustration, that story. So, you know, you were prepared, even though you're not seeing the opportunity. But immediately you saw the opportunity, your preparation just made you fit for it. So even the employer will have no choice than to engage you. Yeah. Wow. I don't know. So also another thing I got from what you said now is mentorship, which mm-hmm. I know that many young people don't even want mentor because mm-hmm. they want give away. Some people just want mm-hmm. give away, help me, give me money. You get, mm-hmm. but I can see even from your life story that mentorship was very key. And it made you focus on what you want to do. And so from that, you knew the skills to acquire. You get. So now, but I believe that some people may not have the opportunity now to have a mentor, a face-to-face mentorship opportunity, or be able to even learn French face-to-face. So I think that even technology will serve this purpose. Technology can help to bridge this gap nowadays. So what would you have to say about that? How young people should embrace technology in terms of mentorship, learning, skills acquisition, career growth, and all that?
You know well that during the time that we were undergraduates or we're just finishing from secondary school, technology, access to technology is not like what we have today, right? So even the young ones of today have better opportunities than you and I when we were growing up, right? Sure. Like then. Sure. And that is because in our case, or in my own case, for example, I had to follow a role model that I see, right? It was because I see him, what he does, I was able to follow through with him. He was teaching me. But today, technology has even bridged that gap. You can even have a role model that does not even know that he's mentoring you. He's a role model to you. And that's true. What technology can do. True. Right? You can identify this person that is doing well or doing what catches your attention or what you have flagged for. And just stay put. You can follow the person on their social media platforms. Sure. You can follow the person on their job website. You can just follow through with the person and learn, right, from the person. If you're able to meet the person in person and you have physical sessions, fine or good. But yeah. I'm saying technology, with technology today, there are a lot of skills that you can learn, right? Even languages. You can learn language from at the comfort of your room. There are apps that can teach you languages, right? So there is nothing that you want to do today, really, that technology cannot aid you to.
Wow. True. Well, thank you very much, Gabriel. It has been an inspiring... I feel like going back to university and starting all over. Like you said, young people have better opportunities now. Mm-hmm. Especially those who are just about to enter university, already in the university. In fact, there are even internship opportunity through internet that you don't need to leave the comfort of your school and go and work. You can work from your school using the internet and earn money and learn skills, have mentors, have role models who are not even in Nigeria. You get. So I think I hope this session will inspire many young people. And if there is a need for us to continue this conversation another day, another time, trust me, I'll come back knocking.
I will.
All right. Thank you very much, Gabriel.
Thank you very much, Charles.
All right. Have a nice day.
You too. All right. Yeah. Bye.